Hi everyone and welcome back to the channel. So in this video we'll be discussing on CARO 2016 and its provisions. So CARO is something which is mandated by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and it is coming under section 143(11) of the Companies Act. So as per section 143 subsection 11, the auditor will have to comply with the provisions of CARO 2016, and whatever disclosures are required by CARO will be coming as part of the audit report as a separate appendix. So if you look at any report of the audit on companies, so if you take any listed companies audit report, you will be finding as one of the appendices the compliance with CARO 2016 would be annexed. So there are very few companies which have been specifically exempt from the provision or the requirements of CARO, and you can use the keyword as BISOP 8. So let's look at what these companies are. So B stands for banking company, I is insurance company, S is a small company as per the Companies Act, then O is a one person company, P is a private company having these parameters. So it should meet these provisions, that is free reserves plus paid up capital should be lesser than 1 crore, borrowing should not exceed 1 crore, and revenue should not exceed 10 crore during that year. So if the company meets all these three provisions, such private company would be exempt from the requirements of CARO. And the last one, which is 8, is a section 8 company. So BISOP 8, these companies are exempted from CARO requirements. The auditor for these companies need not attach the appendix which has the compliance with CARO. So the most important paragraph in CARO is paragraph 3, which contains these 16 clauses which we will be discussing now. So the auditor in his appendix will be attaching the compliance with all these 16 clauses. So if you just read the same the clauses in the same order, so 1 to 16, maybe about 4 to 5 times, then you will be able to remember which clause stands for which particular requirement. So that is, 1 is fixed asset, 2 is inventory, and 3 is loan given by company, 4 is loan to director. So if you associate the number with the provision and read it about 5-6 times, you will be able to remember which clause number stands for which particular provision. Now we will discuss the key points of each of these clauses. So in fixed assets, there are three key points. First one is maintenance of proper records. Second, the management should physically verify the fixed assets at periodic intervals. And third one, if they notice any material discrepancy, so if any physical discrepancies have been identified during that verification, so those discrepancies will have to be fixed. And the same clauses are also hold good for inventory as well. That is, whether physical verification of the inventory has taken place at periodic intervals, and if any material discrepancies were identified, whether they were resolved or not. And the third one is loan given by the company. So if when we go to the clause number 8, you can connect this clause number 3. So clause 3 is loan given by company to others. So in such a case, it should not be prejudicial to company's interest. That is, it should not be against the company's interest or harming the company in any way. And the next one is whether the schedule of repayment has been maintained, and whether the company is getting the EMIs in a periodic manner, in a regular manner. So there should be no default in receiving this loan amounts back. And the third one, if amount is overdue, whether company has taken any steps and what are those steps to recover that. Clause 4 is loan given to the director and investment by the company. So it only has to, the company has to comply with clause section 185 of the Companies Act, which deals with loan to directors. And for investments, it should comply with section 186 of the Companies Act. Then clause 5 deals with deposits. This is deposits received by the company, not deposits given by the company. So if it receives deposits, it needs to comply with section 73 to 76 of the Companies Act. And also if any NCLT order or RBI order has been passed, even that should be complied. If it is not complied with, it should be stated. So it's only two main clauses or two provisions, and one, if it is not complied, you need to state that. And then clause 6 deals with cost records. That is, if the company is prescribed under section 148 of the Companies Act to maintain the cost records, the company should maintain that, and the auditor will state whether the company has maintained it or not. Now we move on to one of the most important clauses, which is clause 7, which deals with statutory dues. So there are only two clauses here. Whatever is undisputed, whether the company is regular in depositing such undisputed amounts, and in case if there are any disputes, what is the amount of dispute and under which forum is that amount or the dispute pending, that should be stated. Clause 8 deals with repayment of loan. So connect this with clause 3, where the company is giving loan. So in clause 3, it is loan given by the company, but in clause 8, it is repayment of loan which is taken by the company. So whether the company is regular in repayment of the loans, and from whom has that loan been borrowed. So if it is not regular, that will be disclosed here. Clause 9 deals with utilization of the IPO. So that is, if the company has raised any funds by way of any IPO or further public offer, the management will be designating a concerned person who will look after the utilization. And the auditor will have to check whether that utilization is as per the requirements for which it was raised, or whether there has been any deviation in the use of those funds. And clause 10 deals with reporting of fraud. So connect this particular clause with section 143 subsection 12 of the Companies Act. So there, as per 143.12, auditor will be reporting frauds which are being made by the officers or employees of the company. But as per clause 10 of CARO, it is fraud by the company and fraud on the company by its officers and employees. So the difference here is, as per section 143.12, only whatever frauds are done against the company by its employees and officers are reported. But under clause 10 of CARO, whatever fraud is done by the company against anyone else, and whatever fraud is done on the company by its employees and officers, is reported. But if someone else, a third party, does the fraud on the company, that is not reported here. And clause 11 deals with approval of managerial remuneration. So this is applicable mainly to public companies. So as per section 197 and as per schedule 5 of the Companies Act, there are certain limits that are placed on the managerial remuneration. And in this clause, the auditor will report whether that is whatever remuneration they have paid is within the limits, or if it is beyond the limits, necessary approvals have been taken or not. Clause 12 deals with needy companies. So this is only applicable to those specific companies and not to any other company. So there are two provisions which the needy companies will have to comply with as per this clause. That is, the ratio of net owned funds to the deposits which they receive. That is, if the nidhi owns 1 lakh rupees as it is its own funds, that is the capital of the nidhi, then it can receive up to 20 times of that amount as deposit from its members. So that is what they are trying to tell here by ratio of 1:20. So if it wants 1 lakh, it can receive up to 20 lakh as deposit. Then this ratio should not be altered. That is, the nidhi cannot be getting deposits of more than rupees 20 lakh from its members. It has to be within that 20 lakh amount. And the second provision is 10% unencumbered term deposit. That is, whatever deposit that the amount that they have got, they need to deposit 10% of that as an unencumbered term deposit for contingencies. So if they have got 20 lakh from their members and 1 lakh as capital, out of that total, 10% of the total would be deposited as a term deposit, which is not given as security for anything. So it is free for the company to use for whatever contingencies that it would require. And clause 13 deals with related party transactions. So it only says that these related party transactions need to be in compliance with section 177 and 188. So 177 is the audit committee section. So whether the related party transactions are approved by the audit committee or not, and 188 deals with the limits on related party transactions and whether the transactions that have taken place are approved by the board and whether they are within the limits or not. And clause 14 deals with private placement of preferential issues. This is only applicable in case the company is making any preferential issue during the year. That is, they issue the securities of the company only to specified persons. So if they are doing that, they need to be in compliance with section 42 of the Companies Act. Clause 15 deals with non-cash transactions. And non-cash transactions, they come under section 192 of the Companies Act. That is, if the company and any other person, for example, its own director, if they are having any transaction which is not in cash, that is, let's say that the director is giving his furniture to the company for its use and he is getting back something else, that is, he may get some assets from the company in return. So let's say he gives the his own furniture for the use of the company and he gets the company's car in return for that. So these are non-cash transactions and they need to be in compliance with section 192. That is, the shareholders of the company would have to approve such a transaction. If they are not approved, then the auditor will be reporting that here. The last one, it deals only with the NBFCs. So NBFCs, if they are operating in India, they need to register with the RBI as per section 45IA of the RBI Act. So if they are not registered, then the auditor will be reporting that here. And if the entity is not an NBFC, this clause would not even be applicable in such a case. So with that, we have completed all the 16 clauses that are reportable under paragraph 3 of CARO 2016. So hope it serves some purpose to you. If you want to remember the clause and the number of the, that is the provision and the clause number, you just have to associate that number with that particular clause. That is, 14 means private placement, 13 is related party, 12 is nidhi company. So you just associate that number with that provision and read it about 5 to 6 times. And you will be getting a hang of which provision is relating to which clause. And for the exam, you don't have to remember each and every point in the clauses in detail. You just have to remember the key points of each clause. So for example, statutory dues means there are only 2 points. That is, whether the company is regular in depositing undisputed dues, and if there are any disputes, what is the amount and where is it pending. So if you are able to remember each clause in this concept capsule manner, you will be able to easily write the questions in the exam. So thank you for watching and hope you learned something out of it.